Blackstone Publishing presents Flynn by Gregory Mcdonald. This book is read by Donald Corren. To Chris and Doug. 1.
Good night, Grover. I'm sure you're right. Flynn slammed the door of the black Ford. It must be nice to be an experienced policeman. Muttering, he went through the gate, along the walk, and up the steps to the porch of the large, dark Victorian house which loomed above him, even of low rank. The Ford accelerated noisily up the 2 o'clock in the morning street and screeched around the corner to the left. "You'd think somebody wanted him home," Flynn said to himself. While he was working the key in the lock of his front door, a jet airplane taking off from Boston's Logan Airport across the harbor thundered only 500 meters above his chimney.
"Oh, God," Flynn said, "I want my tea."
However long he lived there, Flynn heard the noise. Some people, some of his neighbors, were able to put it out of their consciousness, as a driver after a while no longer sees the windshield wipers. Others, more painfully conscious than their neighbors, would have a new round of protest meetings every few weeks. Flynn neither failed to hear the airplanes, nor did he attend protest meetings. He just suffered. In the living room, lit only by the light from the hall, he gazed at his cello, leaning against the curve of the baby grand piano. Once, at 2 o'clock in the morning when they first moved here, he had spent a half hour playing his cello. Neighbors complained, even some who had long since stopped hearing the airplanes. Their message, firmly delivered to Elsbeth the next morning, was something on the order of, "Not jet airplanes and the cello, too, not at 2 o'clock in the morning."
"Ah, well," said Flynn, "where's my tea?"
The kettle itself was keeping him company, still burbling and hissing on the range, when he was halfway through his cup, although he turned the knob. Elsbeth had left out the fixings. Another jet shrieked overhead. Who would want to leave Boston at 2:30 in the morning? Of all the cities he had left, he did not remember ever taking off at such an ungodly hour.
"Da?"
Jenny was in the door. The blue saucer eyes, now sleepy, the golden curly hair, now tousled, the skin of her cheeks a little creased from her pillow, Jenny, at 12 going on 13, had missed the awkward phases all her life, with perfect skin and perfect growing teeth, a perfect little body, and was about to miss the awkwardness of being 13 from all appearances. Proper, of course, as Jenny would be, even at this peculiar hour in her own kitchen, a bathrobe pulled almost around her, an undone package, a present carried under her arm.
"It's yourself, is it?"
Sleepily, she climbed into his lap.
"I had a present."
"A present? Now who'd send my bag of fluff a present?"
She pulled the plain white card from the mess of paper and cardboard under her arm.
"It says, I am Fletcher. That's a funny name."
"Fletcher, is it? That is a funny name."
"When you speak to I am Fletcher, are you supposed to call him you are Fletcher?"
"I see you've been studying your French declensions."
Only Jenny could make him laugh at 2:45 in the morning, especially after Flynn had just arrested a perfectly nice man who had kindly murdered his sick old mother, even laying her out on her own bed, gray hair flowing on the pillow, before calling the police on himself. Grover had been right, of course. The man should be charged with first-degree murder. Mercy murder was not to be recognized ever. There were too many who would take advantage of it. Flynn had argued for a charge of murder with love, whatever that might mean to a court. Flynn knew precious little about the workings of courts.
"The last time I saw your man Fletcher, he was calling himself Peter."
"Do I know him?"
Jenny asked, no part of her mind concerned with the problems of a nice man who had kindly murdered his sick old mother.
"He came here on a Sunday, the day we did the Beethoven F major.
You may remember, 18-1.
"Oh, he was nice, all tight and golden."
"Tight and golden?"
"Like a rubber band."
"Here, let's see what the card says."
Using the back of her wrist, as if she were well used to favors delivered at the door, she passed him the card.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.